Okay, good afternoon. Look, it's good to see you all. Today the National Party and the Greens have formed a memorandum, or signed a memorandum of understanding, which will lead to, I believe, a closer working relationship. It's, I believe, another important step in the maturity of MMP. I look forward to the relationship with the Greens. In my time since I've been the leader of the National Party, we've already started a relationship which was revolved dialogue on a regular basis. This is just another extension of the relationship. Initially, the intention is to work on three important areas that are set out in the agreement. They include home insulation, energy efficiency, and the regulation of natural health products, although I'm sure and confident that it will lead to other areas of cooperation as well. And finally, let me just say that in signing the agreement with the Greens, I think it is an acknowledgement of the expertise that the Greens have in these areas and in other areas. I believe it will lead to stronger legislation, better outcomes for New Zealanders, and therefore it's a very positive thing. So we thank the leadership team of the Greens, Jeanette Fitzsimons and Russell Norman, for signing the agreement with us. We intend to work constructively on that relationship, and we believe it will deliver good outcomes for New Zealanders. On that note, I'm just going to ask Russell to say a few words, and then we're happy to take questions on whatever you'd like.
Thanks, John, and thanks everyone for coming along. We believe the Green Party and the National Party have reached a very practical agreement. It's an agreement which offers New Zealanders the hope of warm, dry, healthy homes. It's important for us that we retain our independent identity and that the agreement reinforces that. We will work with National where we can to make progress, but we absolutely retain the right to speak out and, when we disagree, to say so. We go into the relationship with cautious optimism. We're hopeful that there can be more that we will agree on, and we will pursue that and look for areas where we can find agreement. But we're also realistic. There are limits to what we can do together. It's our job to seek those limits, to stay principled and pursue sensible economic, environment and social policies wherever possible. It's what our supporters want, and it's what we were elected to do. In fact, New Zealanders expect their politicians to act in the best interests of the country as a whole, and that means cooperation. Now, there are more initiatives like the Home Insulation Plan that can be part of a Green New Deal for New Zealand. These programs tackle the economic crisis and the climate crisis at the same time. A Green New Deal is a particular point of focus for the Green Party right now, and we look forward to discussing it further with John Key and his ministers in the coming months. Honest politics is really important to the Green Party, and we commit to working openly and with integrity. We believe it is a healthy sign that MMP continues to mature into a robust system when parties can work together on some things and disagree on others. So we'll leave it there and open it up for questions.
So what do you offer to the
government? We offer expertise in particular areas. In particular, I'm thinking about the energy efficiency and home insulation. In those areas where we're working together with legislation, there will obviously be issues about progress, procedural issues through the House, but we will work on that on a case-by-case basis. It's about jointly making progress on things that really matter.
So does that procedural support widen out to emergency and those sorts of things within the House, or is it just related to those things?
I think the agreement's pretty clear. It's on a case-by-case basis. So we will be treating procedural issues that way. But obviously on those areas where we're working together, if there's legislation around that, then obviously we'll be particularly working to make sure we make progress on those pieces of legislation.
Why do you need this sort of agreement? Couldn't you work together without a piece of paper like this?
Well, from our point of view, we think it's really important to have a clear memorandum of understanding so we understand where each of us, what each of our responsibilities lies. And it's also, as we add to the list, hopefully over time, we've got three areas currently, and we hope to add to that list over time. It makes it very clear to the ministers involved and to the Green MPs involved what are the areas we're working on and what are our responsibilities around each of those areas.
Do you believe that the Green will make them listen to you a bit more?
Well, I'm sure we will be listening to them all, but the basic point here is it's also it's important to understand that the level of engagement, because of the signing of the Memorandum of Understanding, is that the Greens will have full access to Cabinet papers, to officials, so we need to spell that out in a document. Now, they will be bound, like our other confidence and support parties are, not to vote for, ultimately, legislation, but to preserve the confidentiality of that, and I'm sure they will honour that completely. So it's important to have an agreement so that that is spelled out, and it just sends a message to our ministers that we want them to work closely with the Greens on those issues and potentially others.
If you recall, in our election campaign, we were very clear about our position. We said we would work with an incoming national government in areas where we could find common interest. And so we've been working through that process. Now, obviously, National had to put in place a government. There was a lot of negotiations National had to do with its other parties in order to get that all set up. And so I accept that we were, the next round of negotiations, but it was important to us that we take the time and establish where that common ground was. We think, from our point of view, that was the principled and independent position that we said that we would take, and I think we followed through on that.
So you're not assessment of competence by arrangement, but would you consider voting for the upcoming budget?
At this stage, we've made it clear that we're not voting for confidence and supply. We're just identifying areas where we have common interests to see if we can make some progress in those areas. I mean, I think what New Zealanders seek from us is honesty and clarity about what we're doing, and they seek from us to do what is best for the country as a whole. And I think that this kind of cooperation is a mature attempt to actually achieve that.
So you wouldn't agree with what the National Party announced yesterday around the super city and ignoring the
No, we don't agree with that particular aspect of it, but there are some areas around the new arrangements for Auckland where we agree and others where we disagree, and no doubt there'll be discussion on that. But the arrangements we've made about the three issues in the memorandum don't in any way bind us in relation to any other issue at all. You know, it's about a relationship where you are cooperating on some things and opposing on others, and you have to be mature enough to not let the fact that you're cooperating on some issues blunt your opposition on other issues, or the fact that you're opposing on some issues affect your ability to cooperate on others.
Have you talked to Labor about this arrangement, and if so, what's
the role? We've made it pretty clear that we've been talking to National about this kind of arrangement. It's been public that we've been talking about this kind of arrangement, so it's no surprise. Certainly, we made sure that Labor were aware that we were having these negotiations, but then it wasn't a secret. So
who approached who? I mean, did you go to Mr. Key, or did Mr. Key come to the Greens?
Who proposed? Yeah. Well, I was certainly down on one knee for sure. The first thing that's worth, Guy and Ray's point about is it 5 months too late. The first point I think it's worth noting is Jeanette was one of the first phone calls I got on election night, congratulating us. Secondly, I think I made it clear right after the election it was obviously important for the government to be able to put together its numbers, and we did that. This is something we've been working on for some time, so if anyone was sort of dragging the chain a little bit, it was probably on the National side, not on the Green side. Secondly, I think it is an acknowledgement that we can work together. One of the advantages of the structure of this relationship, as indeed it was with the Māori Party, is that there's a lot of flexibility in there, and it shows that we can work through some issues where we don't agree and issues where we can. I think from National's point of view, we're keen to prove that we can work with the Greens on a case-by-case basis, issue by issue, and we do genuinely believe that they'll bring some real expertise, some real understanding, and a different perspective on some issues that are very important to New Zealanders. And as Russell pointed out, I think the New Zealand voting public expect their politicians to club together with the best for the best outcomes, and that's just the move that we're making.
Can you see yourself working together on the emissions trading scheme, and what do you think of their offer to back the bill?
Well, I think it's inevitable at some level we will work on the emissions trading scheme, simply because if you take healthy housing as an example, potentially forestry, they are subsets of climate change policy. Now, in the end, let's sort of see how that progresses. We need to acknowledge up front that the response to climate change proposed by the Greens would probably be quite different from the one proposed by National. That doesn't mean that we can't work on individual strands to get a better outcome.
Last year in the Select Committee, National's minority report contained some issues where we agreed, as well as others where we didn't. And we've made it quite clear all along that we had a hard job deciding last year whether to support the ETS in the form that it was in. We didn't believe it was strong enough. On balance, we negotiated 9 significant changes and agreed to support it. But if we are prepared to talk to National about whether there are ways that our cooperation can make the ETS better, and that would be the basis on which we would be interested.
Mr. Keir, have you made any commitments in terms of funding for any of these policy areas? Because obviously a lot of them would need money down the track.
Yep. Well, there certainly will be access to officials and access to support for the Green Party. I think on a case-by-case basis we can work on that if there's a specific need, but there will be some resourcing that will certainly be available to the Greens.
Would you hope to see a bit more resourcing, maybe signalled at this point, given that the government had cancelled that $1 billion fund that had been agreed between Labor and the Greens?
There definitely will be a budget initiative around that, and we can't obviously release the size of that today. But yes, we're not going into agreements on things that won't be funded in the budget.
So will that be in this year's budget?
Have to wait and see.
So does that mean you will be voting for the budget then?
Not necessarily. You can agree with one, but not necessarily agree with all of it.
Also, Key, how important is this to you strategically? You've now got
Well, I think it is important. It's one thing I can say to you is that when we ask our supporters on who they'd like National to work with, the Greens are right up there, often at the top of the list. In the last survey I saw, a third of our voters wanted us to have a relationship with the Green Party. And I think the reason for that is, you know, we're a big political party. 1 million people voted for us last year. To an awful lot of those people, environmental concerns are a top issue, and they do care about that. So our voters, I think, will want to see us, taking constructive advice and working with the Greens on that issue. And as I said, one of the advantages of the outcome that occurred in 2008 was it allowed us to form a relationship, firstly with the Maori Party. There's no stress in that relationship in so much that we didn't need those numbers to put together a deal. It allowed them to come into that deal. And what you've seen now is, yes, as you saw yesterday, disagreement on a solution to a problem, but in a lot of areas there's been agreement. And I think, again, with the Green Party, this just allows us to prove that we can work on issue by issues. It doesn't mean that the Green Party would form a relationship if they held the balance of power with National in the 2011 election. I think you can't make that claim. But I think we do have an opportunity over the next 2.5 years to show to the New Zealand public that we can work constructively together. Now, let's see where it goes from there.
I just wonder how the Greens feel about maybe giving this National-led government better credibility with you taking your flags very much.
Well, I think that in this kind of a relationship, there is obviously an element of political risk, in a sense. What we're saying is that we are, opening ourselves, each party, to a relationship where there is political risk because we hope that there's the opportunity to do something good. And I think that's what we've got a responsibility to do as political parties, is actually to open ourselves to that risk in order to grasp those opportunities. And I think that goes both ways, actually.
No, but I raised the issue with Kevin Rudd when I was in Australia, and there's been some discussion between our officials and their officials. Now, what I've made clear is that National has a view on what a future agreement between New Zealand and Australia would need to look like in that area, and it's far too early to tell whether that would become acceptable to the Australians. But it's an area where if we could get a carve-out, for instance, for complementary medicines, then it might be that the rest of the relationship or the rest of the agreement for Trans-Tasman Therapeutics could be quite a successful outcome. Now, see what I need to tell.
Yeah,
sure.
high failure, high failure, and Peter Sharp was an investor in the Bay of Chicago.
Yeah.
How are you going to overcome this problem?
Well, look, part of the strength of the relationship with the Maori Party is that there's the provision to agree to disagree. I had a discussion with them last week and gave them a heads up about where we were going. I met with them yesterday before we made the announcement in Auckland. I fully respect their response to the issue yesterday. But in the end, you know, we've made the decision that we think is right for Auckland. There's always the provision under the Local Government Act for Aucklanders to decide whether they want Māori seats. My own personal view is that the advisory committee that we're setting up that will have to, that the Auckland City Council will have to embrace and engage with, will deliver better outcomes than three potentially Māori seats in a council of what would have been 23. So it comes to you, your own personal view of what you think is going to work or not work, but I think if the Auckland City Council embraces a properly structured Māori advisory committee early on across a wide range of areas, we'll get better outcomes. Now, I fully accept that the Māori Party don't agree with that, but we'll just have to agree to disagree on that. Well, Aucklanders can decide that. If Aucklanders decide they want Māori seats in Auckland, the Local Government Act allows them to do that.
But Māori are always going to be the minority.
Well, I don't know. I mean, there's a big Māori population in Auckland. There's typically a fairly low turnout of voting in local government elections. If it's put on the ballot and Māori feel strongly about it, I'm sure they can get it changed.
But the Māori voters' argument is that response to that is that it never happens like that because they are the minority.
Well, it should have been you can't say it never happens like that because one council in New Zealand's already voted for that.
Right.
Yep. So, look, it comes down to what you think is going to work. I personally think engagement, proper engagement, early on across a wide range of issues where there's proper dialogue and proper engagement is more likely to deliver successful outcomes for Māori and Auckland than just necessarily having a couple of two or three seats on the council.
So you're non-negotiable on this? Are you saying just getting
it? Well, like all of the reforms we have in Auckland, they will go through a select committee process. And, you know, governments need to listen to submissions that go to select committees. We'll do that. I mean, obviously, there'll be two effective bills out of yesterday's announcement. One is the transition process, and that'll go through all stages. But the structure of Auckland will go through a select committee process, and we will respectfully listen to those submissions. But the government made its preferred option available for public dialogue yesterday. Not in the slightest. I think both Peter Sharples has already acknowledged in the media this morning that, in fact, if anything, it's a stronger relationship. You just have to accept that sometimes there's going to be the agreement to agree to disagree. There are other things we're working on with the Māori Party, which, you know, I think actually are quite bold steps for us. And, you know, they'll like those bits. If we were exactly the same parties, then there wouldn't be a separation between us. Well, we work through everything on a case-by-case basis. I don't sort of see it as a point-scoring competition. We just do what we think is right. I just don't think that, by decree, having Māori seats in Auckland was the right response to the problem that we faced yesterday.
Could some of the community councils become, in fact, Māori-dominated or even islander-dominated?
Well, there's two important points, I mean, from yesterday. The second is, along with the Māori Advisory Board, there's also going to be one that represents Pacifica and other ethnicities in Auckland, because I think what you've got to acknowledge in Auckland is it's a truly multicultural city. Yes, Mana Whenua have a special place there, and we accept the right of Tainui and Ngāti Whātua, but ultimately, there is also, it's the biggest Pacific Island city in the world. So that's the first thing. The second thing is the way the structure will work is there will be at least, well, there will be three wards coming out of Manukau City. So if, given the percentage of Māori and Pacific Island voters in Manukau City, if they decide not to elect one of the Auckland Council or a number of the Auckland Council representatives is either of Māori or Pacific ethnicity, I would be very surprised. Thirdly, I think ultimately you will see tickets run in Auckland. I think inevitably you will see groupings that come together, and I think those groupings will be of 21 in nature, a mayor, 12 12 councillors for the different wards and 8 for the at-large. And I think you'll see smart tickets put together that represent the quite substantial diversity that is Auckland. And I'd be very surprised if you don't see a mayor or several mayoral candidates coming out with a grouping of by gender, by ethnicity. And that's what smart tickets are going to look like in Auckland.
But isn't it the point that the Māori Party are making, though? I mean, that sounds awfully reasonable. You've got these different ethnicities, but what they're saying is that they've got special status and that they don't want to just give up in with Chinese and Indian communities and by gender, etc., that they've got a treaty relationship with them and that they're going to be able to have special status.
And I acknowledge that. But in the end, that's not about having 3 votes in a council of 23. That's about having input into the policies and outcomes delivered by the Auckland City Council. And that happens when you have engagement and dialogue very early on in the process. I mean, if you take the relationship National has with the Māori Party, I think you can already point to some specific changes and outcomes which the Māori Party have driven by virtue of their relationship with National. It doesn't come because of their votes. We haven't actually had to rely on their votes yet, but it's the nature of the relationship. We treat them with respect and we listen to them. We don't always agree with them. And as it stands with the Green Party today, that's the same point. We intend to treat the Green Party with respect. That means that when we, you know, if they're going to vote for a procedure motion, they get all the information as early as we get it. If they want to be involved in the process around home insulation and healthy housing, they'll get access to all of that information, no secrets. That's the basis of a respectful relationship.
Yep. Have you softened your stance on that so that you won't be repealing that?
Yes, we've softened our stance. Thank you.
Thank you. Cheers.
Have a joint handshake or something?
Yeah.